Marker.
Okay. Can you tell me some of your earliest memories of your father?
The first time I ever remember seeing my father, he came to Coffeyville, Kansas, where my mother and her husband lived there, and I lived there with them. And I must have been about 5 years old or something like that. And I remember he impressed me because he was so well-dressed and he looked so nice and everything. You know, I thought he looked like a movie star. And, you know, it's the first time I'd ever seen him, and it really impressed me by the way he looked and the way he talked and the relationship that we had for the first time when we met.
Now, when you were born then, was your dad actually still in prison from the first arrest? Was that?
No, my father was with my mother and I when I was born. But after that, it was only about a year, I think, after that he was put in prison. I'm not sure about the dates, but I was very young, and I hadn't seen him in, you know, 4 years, or I'd never remembered seeing him when I was a little baby, but then the first time, I think I was about five.
Do you have any favorite stories about when your dad would come to visit you and your mom, or your family? I know you had lots of cousins and stuff. What was it like?
Well, it was like Christmas time or something. Everybody was happy.
Charles Dempsey Floyd. Charles Dempsey Floyd, take two.
Mark?
Okay, so what was it like when your dad came to visit?
Well, it was really exciting. Everybody was excited about seeing him, and he always would bring presents for people and, you know, give kids money, and everybody really loved him. I mean, I've never known anybody that really knew my father that didn't like him. And, you know, I know he's been in the newspaper portrayed as a mad dog killer and a person like that, but he wasn't that kind of a person. I mean, I'm not trying to make excuses for him, but he was really a wonderful person, and he loved his family and his friends, and it just never ceases to amaze me how many people still are interested in him. You know, I get letters and calls and stuff, interviews in different papers and everything, and after 50 years, he's still a very popular person, and people always want to know about him and everything, you know.
You told Leslie a story about him actually coming in the middle of the night and, I think, bringing a pig or something. Was that normal for him to come in the middle of the night?
Yeah, well,
what would it be like? Just tell me the story about it.
Mostly he'd travel by night to keep from being detected, you know, and that's when we lived on that, you know, that picture I showed you lived out there.
I'm sorry, could you just, we might show the picture, but if you talk about the picture you showed me, then it doesn't work too well. So
anyhow,
tell me about how he'd arrive at night.
Anyhow, we lived out in the middle of a field on a farm, and he'd have to leave his car on the road and walk in.
Okay.
Shall we cut him?
Yeah, let's cut.
Mark?
So, what was it like when he came?
Well, my father usually traveled at night. And even if he came in the middle of the night, everybody was happy to see him, and he'd usually bring gifts for people and give kids money and usually bring me a present like a dog or some kind of a toy or something, you know. And everybody was always glad to see him. I remember one time I was living with my mother's father and mother, and in the middle of the night, my father came and brought a pig, and my grandmother got up and cooked that pig just like a Christmas dinner at like 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. And people were always wanting to do things for him and everything. And I remember he told my grandfather, he said, find out who that pig belonged to and pay him for it. Give him like $10 or something. You know, I said, tell him that I really enjoyed it. He said, the reason I shot that pig was that I was out looking at my tire and the pig came up and kicked me. He was always full of jokes and stuff, you know. He was really a fun person to be around. I mean, it's kind of hard to believe that Public Enemy Number One would be a fun person to be around, but he was. I've never met anybody that really knew him that didn't like him.
And how did regular folks, like not your family, but how do they feel about your dad? I mean, I've heard him described as kind of a Robin Hood. Do you have any stories about that?
Well, I've heard a lot of stories. I've been, you know, went on a tour with a movie one time and on talk shows and stuff, and I got calls from people that told they met him, and people liked to do things for him, you know, like if they didn't know him, and if he had a tire, a flat tire or something, somebody'd come along and change it, he'd pay him for it. And they would always want to tell, hey, fixed a tire for Pretty Boy Floyd, or Pretty Boy Floyd gave him a ride. Kids are always saying stuff like that, you know.
So what was it about the times and the way life was in the Depression and in Oklahoma, where a lot of people were poor farmers, that you think made them really kind of admire and make a kind of hero out of your dad?
Well, they needed a hero about then. You know, the banks were going under and taking people's money and foreclosing on farms and everything. And I think that the people felt that my father was just one of them, kind of striking back for all of them. And, you know, it was like they didn't have any TV or many radios in those days, and they'd follow his escapades in the paper, you know, and it was kind of like they were pulling for him to stay at large instead of being killed. He's probably the only criminal I've ever heard of that people wanted for him to stay alive and at large instead of being captured.
So they would be willing to hide him, right? They hid him out?
Oh,
do
yeah.
Do you have any favorite stories about that, you know, specific instances?
Well, I know... one time when my father came to see us, there was a ex-sheriff who was kind of like a bounty hunter, and they had a gun battle, and Irv Kelly was the man's name. He got killed, and my father got wounded. And my father went to his older brother down in Earlsboro, and where he worked in the oil field. And he took him to somebody's house, and they hid him for a month until he got recuperated, and a doctor would come there and doctor him and stuff. And my mother and I went down there, and we became acquainted with them. They were really nice people, and I started calling them aunt and uncle. I thought they were relatives, you know, and they were just people that my uncle knew. And I think my father could go places and tell people who he was, and they would protect him instead of turning him in. I mean, I've heard a lot of instances like that. Even when he got killed, the lady that gave his last meal, her brother was getting ready to take him to town somewhere where he could catch a bus at the time, you know, that he was on foot out in the woods and farmland there.
I've heard that he would, you know, drop by, and if he needed a meal, he'd always, after he got a meal, he'd leave a little money under the plate. Can you describe that to me?
I've heard that a lot of times. That in fact... this lady I'm talking about, her name was Conkle. She told my mother that my father wanted to pay her for the meal, but I don't think she would take it. But he didn't want to take anything from the common, ordinary working man. He didn't mind taking the bank's money, but he didn't want to take anything from somebody like that.
I just want to sort of broaden up the picture for a little while now. You come from a really big family, I know, in Oklahoma. How did, other than your dad, how did folks in your family make a living?
Well, most of my family were farmers. My grandfather, on both sides, they were farmers originally. And my dad's father, before he was killed, he had a little store and a little barber chair in there, and he did a little bit of everything. It had like a little general store. But originally, he was a farmer, and my grandfather was a farmer, and my uncles farmed a lot.
And was it a hard life?
Yeah, it was hard, but it was really a good life, because we didn't have any money much, but we always had plenty to eat because we'd grow stuff, and my grandmother would can things and everything. And I lived close to a creek and a river. We used to go fishing, and, you know, you had to do a lot of work during the week, but on the weekends you could go fishing or do stuff that you enjoyed. We had horses. We'd ride the horses and stuff.
So do you remember anything about the poverty of the Depression days? Did you feel affected by that?
Well, you know, if you're born in poverty, you just kind of accept it. But I can remember instances now that it comes to mind that really brings to mind how poor we really were.
Excuse me, Chair, I have to cut for a second.
Okay. Stop for a second. This is just a technical thing. You're doing terrific. Are you comfortable?
Oh, yeah.
I was asking you about poverty, but I know you have a really interesting story about the little house that you lived in, that mm-hmm. boxcar house. Can you tell me about that, what it was like in the summer and the winter?
Well, you look back now and you realize how deep you were in poverty, you know. Like, I have a picture of that house I was telling you about. They called it a boxcar house. It was made out of 1-inch boards, and it had a tar paper roof, which wasn't very high above your head. And then over these cracks, when you put two boards together, they'd put what's called a slat over that board to keep the wind from coming through. And I know my grandmother used to save all the newspapers she could find, and she'd make paste out of flour and water and paste the inside of the house newspaper. It was papered with newspapers on the inside of the house to keep the wind from coming in. And it was cold in the winter and hot in the summer. And it was just the poorest excuse for a house. But, you know, if you're born there, you don't pay much attention to it. But now you look back and you can see how really bad it was. You had no running water and naturally no heat except wood stoves. And it was a two-room house. We had a kitchen and the other room, and they both had beds in them because there was my grandmother and grandfather, and then my two uncles and I lived in the other room. So it was pretty bad, but if you know, that during the time you don't think about it. Now you look back and you see how bad it really was, you know.
Now your grandfather you're talking about, he was a sharecropper, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Tell me a little bit about what his life was like.
He was a sharecropper.
Sorry, could you say my grandfather,
my mother's father was a sharecropper. That's, you live on somebody else's farm and you raise the crops and everything, and when the crops are gathered, they divide it. You get a certain percentage of the farm. It was hard work because he never had tractors. He always used horses and mules and stuff, you know, and he'd work from daylight to dark and for very little money, you know.
This is great. We just ran out of film, which we have to.
Okay, now we're changing to camera roll 312-24, and it's Charles Dempsey Floyd, take 5.
Okay, you were just telling me about your father as a sharecropper, and your grandfather.
My grandfather. Yeah, my grandfather was a sharecropper. He lived on another person's farm that owned the land. He'd raise the crops, and then when the crops were gathered, they would divide it, a certain percentage for each one.
And then did you and your uncles all work the land too? Were you a...
Well, yeah, I helped. My uncles, they usually did the plowing and everything, and I got the hoe. You know, the bottom of the line, you start with that hoe and work your way up to the plow. But I never got up to the plow. I always had that hoe in my hand until I went into the Navy. But it was always, it was hard work, but, you know, you enjoyed I enjoyed being outdoors and able to, on the weekends to go fishing and hunting and stuff, because I lived close to a creek and a river and stuff.
I was going to ask you now about your dad, and he had made this decision to rob banks, and did he have a kind of, I'm just going to cut. I was wondering if your dad sort of had a kind of standard procedure for going in and robbing a bank, that if you can describe that, if you knew stories about how he did it.
Well, I've never really heard too much about it from anybody, but what I've been able to gather by reading the newspapers and everything, he planned his bank robberies. He wasn't just a haphazard person, or he wouldn't have stayed at large as long as he did. You know, I'm sure they would, what they call, case the bank, look it over and everything before they did the robbery. And he always had, I've talked to my uncles about it, he always had two ways to get out of town, not just one. You know, if one was blocked, he'd have another way to get out of town. And many times he wouldn't go very far after he did the bank robbery. He would hide at some farmer's house or something so he wouldn't be captured along the road. And I think he just planned things ahead of time. And when he went in, he looked like another banker or a businessman or something. You know, he didn't look like a bank robber, I don't suppose, until bank robbers started imitating his style and everything. He dressed well, and he'd probably go in and talk to the banker. And you're going to have to do something about the dog, I think.
It's going to be Charles Dempsey Floyd, take 7 up.
I mean, you think they wanted to go when they were really... Yeah,
probably.
They saw enough.
Mm-hmm.
So why didn't your dad disguise himself when he went off to do these things?
I don't know. I think he just felt that he could, he was been pretty successful getting away from people and hiding and that kind of thing. And I don't think a disguise would have fooled anybody anyhow. But a lot of people started using his method of operation and dressing like him, and he got blamed for a lot of banks that he really didn't rob. Because I know one time when I first started school, we for about 6 months, my father hadn't been anywhere. And he stayed right there when I first started school. And every week we'd hear where he robbed a bank in Kansas or in Arkansas or somewhere. And the other guys got pretty smart, you know. They dressed like him and did his thing, and he got blamed for it. And, you know, a lot of banks, when they were banks were going broke and everything, they got robbed by their own people. Brother-in-law or somebody would come in and rob them, and then the bank would be off the hook.
When your dad seemed to often take a hostage to get out of town, but he seemed to really try to avoid violence. I was wondering if he ever talked to you about that.
Well, I heard a real interesting story that my uncle told me about one time. My father robbed a bank, and he thought maybe that the police had the roads covered or something, you know. So he took two hostages. They had running boards in those days on the cars, so he put one on each side. And after he got out of town about 8 or 10 miles, he stopped, and these guys were just petrified. You know, they thought he was going to get killed or something because they'd heard what a mad dog killer and everything he was, probably, you know. And that's natural to be scared when people got guns and everything, you know. So my dad stopped. He said, "Well, fellas, I hate to put you out here, but says you'll probably get a ride back. Says we'll have a drink together before you go." So he had a bottle in the car, and they all had a drink of whiskey, and he left them there and didn't harm them. I've always been glad and proud that my father wasn't the type of person that went in and pistol-whipped people and shot people for no reason at all, you know. I know he's probably killed some people, but he never killed anybody, a banker or a teller or anybody, during a robbery, you know. I'm sure some of the police officers that were trying to kill him, he killed, but he wasn't the type of person to just go in and shoot everybody and take the money. And I was glad that that never happened.
And when you were growing up, were you aware that people were trying to capture your dad?
I knew from the start that he was a wanted man. Like when I went to school, they put me in school under a fictitious name. My father was going by the name of Jack Hamilton. So they entered me in school when I first started school under the name of Jackie Hamilton. And I knew the reason for it, and I was protective of him, you know. I didn't want to see him hurt or anything, so I went along with it, and that's the reason till this day I'm still called Jack, which isn't really my name, you know. My real name is Charles Dempsey Floyd.
Were you sort of proud that your father was able to escape? Was it exciting, or was it scary?
Well, it was scary in a way, but you always were relieved to know that if he robbed a bank or something, he got away. And, you know, it was always a worry of my mother and my dad's relatives and everything. They're always worried. They knew someday it was going to happen, you know, and it was always on their mind. And I know I worried about it, too, even as a child. But if somebody you love, you're gonna pull for them to escape or get away, no matter what they've done. You want them to stay, you know, you want to be with them and don't want them hurt.
When your father did go to prison once, when you were a young boy, mm-hmm. But then after that it seemed like he really was determined not to get caught, or at least not to go back to prison. Did he talk about that ever?
Well, he didn't talk to me a lot about things like that, but I've heard it from my uncles and my mother and things, you know. I know he spent 5 years, I think it was, in prison when I was just, I think I was about a year old when he went in prison, or maybe 4 years or something. Anyhow, the early part of my life he was in prison, and the first time I ever saw him I was probably about five and a half years old. And I think prison was a real bad experience for him, and he probably learned a lot of things that he shouldn't have learned from some of the older prisoners and stuff. I've read where he had older friends that told him how to do things and everything, you know. So I've heard people say that my father said he'd never go back to prison again. And he was captured one time after that and on the way to prison and had handcuffs on. He jumped out of the train, out of the window, or got away from the police officer and escaped. And there was just another example of how he could do things. He probably went to some farmer's house and told him who he was, and they sawed those handcuffs off of it.
Amazing. You talked before about this one man, Irv Kelly, who was sent out. I think he was sent out actually by the State Bankers Association, kind of to track your dad down. Did you know much about the events of that evening? He was coming.
He was coming to see my mother and I.
Could you just say your dad was coming?
My father was coming to see my mother and I. We were with my grandfather and my grandmother there in Cecil Bennett's farm out about 4 miles from Bixby. And it was in the nighttime. He usually traveled, and it was in nighttime. And Irv Kelly and some more people were staked out. Evidently, they thought they'd wait there sometime. They thought maybe my father would be coming in. Irv Kelly was, I think, more like a bounty hunter. He wasn't really, he was an ex-sheriff or ex-deputy sheriff or something. And the way it happened, I understand, he was, Irv Kelly was behind a chicken house. And in those days, you had gates to keep the stock in, and somebody, you had to stop and open the gate to go into where we live. We live back in the field, away from the road, you know. And so my father got out to open the gate, and Irv Kelly stepped out from behind the chicken house and told him that he was under arrest or whatever, you know. And then there was a gun battle between Irv Kelly and George Birdwell and my father. And I don't know who killed him, but somebody killed Irv Kelly, and my father got wounded pretty bad. But I heard about it, but he never made it into to see us that time. He just got that close and then had to leave.
And do you know where he went afterwards?
I'm sure he went to his older brother's down around Earlsboro, and I'm sure he did. He went down there, and he arranged to have a doctor and arranged for a place for him to stay until he got healed up.
Can you tell me, there's a story about your brother, your dad had a younger brother, E.W.,
mm-hmm.
right? And can you tell me the story about sort of when E.W. was trying to decide about whether or not he might go work with your dad and sort of what went on between the two of them?
My father and all of his family were very close, and E.W. and all of his sisters and brothers loved him dearly. And E.W. was younger, and he wanted to go with my father. And my father wouldn't let him do it, and they had a, I think they had a physical fight over it one time or other, some kind of a skirmish. But anyhow, he told him he wanted him to stay out of that kind of thing. He had a wife and young boys, and he knew it wasn't the kind of life that would be good for him.
So what did he say to E.W., do you know?
I really don't know what he said, but I'm sure he just told him that it was no life. You know, you're constantly running and hiding, and you don't know when you're going to get to see anybody. You might have to sleep in the woods or... it's just a miserable life, you know. It might look exciting to somebody, but you look at the end, that way it came down and everything. He was constantly on the run. He might have had a lot of money at one time or other, but it didn't do him any good. You know, you have to pay dearly for everything you have done, and you got no place to go and really relax or have fun like you should be able to.
Why do you think your dad made this decision? I mean, he made the decision as a pretty young man to go turn to, you know, robbery.
A life of crime? I think he just, he was a very ambitious person. I've talked to people that he went to school with and people, you know, and they said it's a shame he got into the wrong thing because he would probably have been successful at anything he did. But he wasn't making much money. He was working working in the wheat harvest up in Kansas, and I don't know who got the arranged the.
We're just rolling. Same answer again.
And in the sound roll.
And you were telling me about his working in the wheat
Michael.
Fields. Mm-hmm. So maybe you can just start that story over.
Okay.
Again.
Mark.
Tell me that.
So we were talking about my father, what reason he went into crime. What I believe, what I've heard from a lot of the friends and people that I've talked to and everything, he was an ambitious type person, and he wanted more than he had. He'd like to have the nicer things in life, you know, like cars and homes and stuff like everybody'd like to have, you know. But he wasn't making much money. He was working in the wheat harvest up through Kansas. You know, there would be crews that would go with the combines and thrashing machines and stuff, you know, and they'd just go through the farmlands and work, and they worked for a wage, which wasn't too much. Anyhow, somehow he got involved with some people that one person worked at the store, and then another person, and there was three of them, planned to rob and get the payroll for a large department store. In those days, they didn't use checks to pay, they used cash, you know, pay envelopes, so they robbed and got quite a bit of cash, I think, like, seemed to me like it was $11,000 or something, which was a tremendous amount of money in those days. And my father and his friend both spent too much money and bought new cars and went home with a lot of new clothes and everything, which stuck out like a sore thumb, you know. So he got caught, and he went to prison. And in those days, there wasn't much programs for rehabilitating prisoners and stuff. And I understand he tried to go to work with his brother, and he got laid off from a job in the oil fields because they heard that he was an ex-convict. And I'm not sure, but maybe he just decided, well, if they're not going to give me a chance, I'll just do what I've done before. And he just got started, and it never stopped.
Was he angry about anything? Was he angry about banks? Was he angry at the oil companies because they kind of turned him out?
I don't know. I was pretty small. I was only 10 years old when my father got killed. And the short time that I spent with him, the most time I ever spent with him was 6 months, and I was only about six then. For any length of time, and we really never got into talking. I was a little young for him to explain things to me like that. But I just think he just got started, and it snowballed, and he figured there was no other way out because he tried to get work and everything when he first got out of prison, and it didn't work out. And he just, it became easy for him, I guess you might say that. You know, he was at large about 8 years, I guess, and robbed numerous banks, and I guess it just became easy enough he decided to go ahead and do it.
Mm-hmm. There's some stories about your dad robbing the Salisaw Bank, which was actually a town where he was sort of from, where lots of people knew him. Can you mm-hmm. tell me the story about how he did that?
Well, I've heard the stories that this bank had taken his grandfather's money, which he had in the bank, and my grandfather asked the banker the day before the bank went bad if his money was safe, and he told him it was, and then evidently the bank started up again. And so my father went to his grandfather and told him, he says, "Grandpa, I said, I want you to sit across the street over there at the depot and watch this. I'm going to rob the bank here today." So he robbed the bank, and the next time he saw his grandpa, he says, "Grandpa, did you see me rob the bank?" And he says, "No, it was nice and warm. I went to sleep and missed the whole thing."
What did the other folks in Salisaw feel about this kind of like local boy, you know, someone they all knew coming into town and robbing the bank?
Well, it's just like most of the people in those days, they were on my father's side. You know, they felt that he was striking back for the little person or something. And I don't think it bothered them at all. I think they was kind of proud that he did it.
That's amazing. Did you have a sense that your dad's kind of escapades and activities were exaggerated by the press? Did they kind of get...
Well, they went overboard on it sometimes. I know I've read stories where he was a mad dog killer and all that kind of thing. He wasn't that type of person. He never really hurt anybody in the banks that he robbed during a robbery. He never went in and shot people or beat them over the head with a pistol. Like Bonnie and Clyde were really like that, you know. They were sadistic type person. He wasn't that kind of person. And people that really knew my father would tell you he was really a nice person to be around, and he was a lot of fun. He was always laughing and joking, keeping people laughing.
I've read again stories about your dad sort of having to write to the editor of a newspaper and say, "Hey, I didn't rob that bank. I wasn't there. Do you remember any cases like that?
Just things that I've read about my father doing, but I'm not sure that it happened that way.
Okay. I know that you and your mother sometime, I think while your dad was still alive, actually, would go out and give talks in movie theaters about...
Yeah, we were on like a vaudeville circuit.
Could you say
circuit.
My mother
and I were on, we went to different theaters, and we'd go on stage and in between the movies and talk. I'd go out and introduce my mother, and she'd come out and talk about how terrible it was to live with the thought of her husband being killed every day and the life of crime. You know, we never had any money. He'd send us money sometimes, but really it was a terrible thing. And I really enjoyed that because we went to the nicest hotels and ate the nicest food and had good clothes and everything. So it was kind of a fun thing for me.
What did people ask you questions? I was curious what they were interested in, what they wanted to hear about.
Same thing that you want to hear about. They wanted to know about... what kind of person my father was, you know. And kids were just, they idolized him, you know. Kids my age they treated me like I was a movie star's son or something, you know, because he was really a hero for the common people in the Midwestern states. He was the only outlaw that I've ever heard of that people wanted him to stay at large and not get killed or caught or anything.
Yeah, one other thing, I'm curious about your dad's got two different nicknames, and I'm actually kind of curious about both of them. What do you know about the name Pretty Boy Floyd, and did your father like that name?
No, he didn't like that name, and nobody that really knew him ever called him that. It was
Could you say, no one that really knew him ever called him Pretty Boy Floyd, because it's, again, they're going to cut out my question.
Well, nobody that really knew my father and really was a friend of his ever called him Pretty Boy Floyd. It was the newspapers and police and everything that it was a colorful name, and it stuck with him, and it just became like Robin Hood or something like that, But he didn't really like the name.
And your dad did have a kind of family nickname, which was Chalk, and I wonder if you could tell me, what that comes from.
Well, my father had a nickname Chalk, which was the name for a uncured whiskey that the stills used to make, and they'd bury these barrels of whiskey until they got ripe or cured or something. They were in one state. They were in a what they call chalk beer, and he and his friends used to raid these places and get this chalk beer and drink it and have a good time on it and go to the dances and everything. And he liked it so well they nicknamed him that, I guess.
Do you have memories? It was moonshine, and I know it was Prohibition days during this time. Do you remember the people in your family or the people in the area where you came from in Oklahoma making moonshine? And
well, I never remember any of our family that really had whiskey, what they call whiskey stills, and made moonshine. But I know they were in the mountains and in the area where my father used to live. But nobody of my family that I can remember ever, I didn't know about it if they did it.
Okay, let's cut for a second. And
Mark?
Okay. You're going to tell me some more about your dad and, I guess, humor and his warmth.
Mm-hmm. There's a story about my father that I like. When I was born at my aunt's house, my mother's aunt. And it was during the wintertime. It was in December. And after I was born, in a few hours or so after I was cleaned up and everything, my father took me and went to the mirror with me and held me up to the side of his face, and says, "Oh, look, he looks just like me." And you know how kids will do their hand like this. I had big hands anyhow. And he said, "Look," I was doing my hands like that, and he said, "Look, he's going to be a fighter. We're going to call him Jack Dempsey." But my mother wouldn't go for it. She went for part of the name, but that was, I thought that was kind of nice that he did that.
That's nice. Did you grow up with a sense that sort of an ambivalent feeling about your dad? Did you know that he was doing something wrong at the end?
Oh, yeah. I knew from the very start that he was a wanted person. And when I first started school, I knew that he was wanted because they entered me in school under a fictitious name. And I was protective as a child can be of his father, But I enjoyed being with him, and we did a lot of fun things, and he kept us laughing a lot. He'd tease my mother about different things. I know one time I came home from school, and my mother was always afraid that I was going to be kidnapped for some reason or other. But anyhow, I passed these larger boys, had a pulley and thing up in one tree, and went down to another, and you get in this bucket and ride from one tree down to the other, kind of like a carnival ride or something, so it was fascinating fun, and I stayed after dark. When I went home, my mother was just scared to death, and I finally got home. She told my father, says, "Now, you've never given him a whipping," says, "it's your turn to discipline him." And it had been raining that day, and I had a raincoat on. So I said, "Okay, I'll whip him." So he took me in the bathroom, and he said, "You take that raincoat off and put it over the toilet stool." And said, "Every time I hit it with the belt, you yell." So he was beating the raincoat, and I was yelling. My mother was trying to break the door down. She said, "I didn't tell you to kill him, so I just told you to give him a spanking." But he never hit me. Ever in his life did he ever hit me in any way like that.
What was it like when he came to visit?
It was like Christmas time or something. It was a special occasion when he came around. Everybody was proud to see him, and he'd always bring gifts and give the kids money and bring me a dog or some kind of a gift. And everybody was just really happy to see him. And usually my grandmother would cook him a nice meal, which he always loved her cooking, her biscuits and stuff like that. And it was just a good time when he was around.
Woody Guthrie wrote a song about your dad.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember that song?
Yeah, I remember it.
The
first time I ever heard the song about my father, my daughter was singing it. I had never heard it when I was a kid because we never had a record player and didn't have a radio very much of the time when I was a kid. And I had never heard it. And it was on the Joan Baez album. I bought my daughter a guitar for her birthday when she was about 12 years old, I think. And she was playing this song and singing. I said, where did you hear that song? She said, well, it's on that album, Joan Baez album. And, you know, there's a couple of sayings in there that are used quite a bit, and nobody seems to know where they came from. Like, and it says, through this life you'll wander, through this life you'll roam, you'll never see an outlaw drive a family from their home. Well, Woody Guthrie was trying to say the banks were driving people from their home, but the outlaws were trying to help them. And another famous saying or cliche or whatever you want to call it was, in this life you'll meet a lot of strange men. Some will rob you with a six gun, some will rob you with a fountain pen. And that's still true today. The guys that go to a liquor store and hold up with a gun get 5 years, and maybe somebody in a bank will embezzle $1 million and they're looked on like they're a hero.
Great, great. Okay, let's cut. That's great.
Oh, and what happened? Did he tell you, you guys leave?
Charles Dempsey Floyd, take 10.
Tell me what happened.
And we're going to go to a new camera roll, 3.
Mark. Okay. So you yourself actually got in the middle of this kind of escaping from the police. Can you tell me any stories about that?
Well, when my mother and father and I were living in Tulsa one time, we'd lived there, I guess, 2 or 3 months or something, and somehow the police got information that that's where my father was staying or something. And they raided the house, but evidently my father had a friend somewhere that told him the police were coming. And when they got there, my father and George Birdwell at the time, he was a partner of my father, they were gone. And I remember seeing the police come through the house and go in the back and look and everything. But my father and George were already gone. But you know, it was kind of quite an experience for a kid to go through something like that.
That Sheriff Cotton, is that the, I mean, Ruth was remembering one of the lawmen who would often come out to, I guess, the house that she lived in looking for your dad. Do you remember that? Do you remember him coming?
I remember that name, but I don't ever remember seeing him. He probably came to there. They lived down at Haskell. It might have been a sheriff down there. A lot of the sheriffs and police officers would have liked to have been able to capture my father. It'd been a pretty good feather in their cap or something, you know. So they kept surveillance a lot on places they knew that my father would frequent. Like, he'd go to that Ruth's father and mother, my aunt and uncle. He'd go there a lot because he liked them, and they treated him real well and everything. He liked to be around the kids.
Did you have a sense that there was kind of like a network of people that were protecting your dad and passing information on to keep him safe?
Well, I think it was just everybody, really. There was very few people that would say something that they would think that would hurt my father or endanger him or something. I think just the everyday people would do that. I know my father has went to strange people, and they would hide him out and stuff, you know, and he'd even tell them who he was. And I just think it was just a general thing. It wasn't just a certain group. It was just practically everybody except the police, maybe, or the bankers.
Leslie, were you?
Mark?
Okay. Dad had a real sense of humor?
Yeah, my father had a nice sense of humor. He'd always keep people laughing and everything. And the short time that I really got to be with him, I got to know him pretty well, and he was always kidding around with my mother and everything, you know, and keeping her laughing. And he'd cook for us and do different things like that. I remember one time he took me fishing. So we went up in the mountains somewhere and to a lake, and we couldn't get the fish to bite, but it was a very clear lake, and we could see them, you know. And he said, you know what we ought to do? So we ought to shoot those fish. We can't catch them. So he let me shoot the gun and into the water like we're going to shoot a fish, you know. But we didn't get one. But, you know, it was just something he thought I'd like to do, which was a lot of fun.
Yeah, yeah. I think I'm done. Yeah.
Next is room tone for the Charles Dempsey Floyd interview.
Well, did you get what you wanted, you think?
Absolutely.
I felt it.
Thank you.
This is the end of the recording for Charles Dempsey Floyd.